42 years ago, when the world of computing was just taking shape, physicist Richard Feynman took the stage at MIT to give a keynote speech. He started by admitting that he didn't know what a keynote speech was, but then went on to talk about something that he thought nobody else at the conference would talk about. What he shared was his vision for quantum computing. Quantum computing is a technology that is coming into its own right now, and the breakthroughs that we're seeing today were in many ways anticipated by Feynman's brilliant insights in his 1981 lecture.
But then you can't claim to know anything about it.
This video is a collaboration with Q Control, a global quantum technology company headquartered in Sydney that makes this technology useful through its infrastructure software products for quantum computing and quantum sensing. Many of the animations that I'll use in this video are from Q Control's educational platform called Black Opal. Feynman dared to speak about quantum computers the same year that IBM released their first personal computers. It was a time when computers were big, bulky machines, primarily used by businesses for record keeping, with tiny amounts of storage and RAM. The internet didn't exist. And yet Feynman already wanted to push computers to their limit. He titled his talk, Simulating Physics with Computers, something that meant he had to first admit that even physicists don't understand the world perfectly.
But I'm not absolutely sure of anything, and there are many things I don't know anything about. I don't feel frightened by not knowing things.
Even today, there's a lot of physics that we still don't understand, and so we need computers to help us learn more. But what kind of physics do we want to learn about? Some physics can be approximated just fine by solving things like differential equations. Feynman gave this speech after people had traveled to the moon, after all, using math and physics that could, for a large part, be computed by hand. When Feynman says simulating physics with computers, he is referring to the task of trying to mimic or copy physics to create an accurate simulator of our world. He isn't talking about other tasks like adding numbers or sending emails. Those you can do just fine on a normal computer. We already do a lot of simulations on computers to approximate nature. Feynman's vision was to move away from approximations and invent a computer that could do exactly the same as nature. Feynman says that the physical world is quantum mechanical, and therefore the proper problem is the simulation of quantum physics. Quantum physics refers to the world of the very small, since a quantum is the smallest possible unit of something. On the quantum scale, particles can seem to behave strangely, existing in a cloud of probabilities, only collapsing into a definite state once we measure them. Conventional bits in a computer, ones and zeros, can't keep track of quantum information. Feynman's 1981 speech was actually the first work to specifically discuss the construction of a machine that would operate on quantum mechanical principles, using hardware that employs quantum physics itself to keep track of it accurately. He came up with just one rule for something that would match his vision, that the size of the computer would only need to be proportional to the size of the physical system it was simulating. That is, he said, if you want to explain this much physics, I can do it exactly, and I need a certain sized computer. If doubling the volume of space and time means I'll need an exponentially larger computer, I consider that against the rules. That's followed by a comment saying, I make up the rules. I'm allowed to do that. Most conventional computers fail this rule when trying to simulate nature because every time you add just one more particle to keep track of, you're adding a near infinity of new places it could be, and it becomes exponentially harder to compute. Feynman says that to get around this, we should let the computer itself be built of quantum mechanical elements, which obey quantum mechanical laws. So what are these quantum mechanical elements? Well, I'm going to use the Black Opal platform to demonstrate this next bit. As it says here, the fundamental unit of quantum information is the qubit. In normal computing, we have bits of information that can be either a 0 or a 1, but for a qubit, the information is much more crowded. It can be pictured as a sphere, and we need two numbers to specify how much the qubit is a 1 and how much it is 0. These qubits, especially when you have multiple of them, contain a lot more information than conventional bits can hold. And so given the fact that we hope to have quantum computers with millions of qubits one day, this will take us to a realm far beyond what conventional computers are able to do. Here's a qubit that we can play around with. The top of it is marked as the zero state, and the bottom being marked as the one state. If the blue line is the state of our qubit, then we can move it all around the sphere, swapping from 0 to 1 or somewhere in between. There's an infinite range of possible options where the state of the qubit can live on the surface of the sphere, and that corresponds to the increased information storage in quantum computers. There's more than one way to make a qubit, and really it comes down to needing two energy levels that are separated by some known gap. That's because with quantum physics, it's a lot about energy at its fundamental scale. And with energy, you can have something called a ground state, which is the lowest energy of a system, and then an excited state, where it's, you know, elevated one above that. And an example given here in this energy level diagram shows, I think, a particle in a ground state in blue that when it's hit with light, it might absorb some energy and thus go to an excited state where it has more energy than it did in the ground state. And it could give off or emit that energy to go back down. And that is fundamentally the kind of dynamic needed to make a qubit. One practical way that people can engineer that kind of system is with trapped ions. The ion in this case is an atom that has lost an electron and so has gained a positive charge. And because of that, it can be trapped using electric forces. So they have this trapped ion, and because it has one lonesome electron remaining in its valence shell, they can actually manipulate that electron with lasers. So hitting it with a laser might be able to put it up into its excited state, and then coming down again, it can go back to its ground state, probably emitting light in the process. And that's how they're able to control this qubit using lasers and electric forces and voltages. Though they might be small now in terms of the number of qubits rather than the overall size, quantum computers are real and available for anyone to use. Many labs and institutions are racing to make them better, and today you can write programs that run on quantum computers. Quantum computers aren't just good for simulating nature, they are also powerful at solving other problems that also get exponentially more complex, such as optimization and cryptography. Quantum computers have the potential to improve many different fields and industries drastically, but if the problem doesn't have exponential complexity, then you wouldn't need a quantum computer to solve it. You'd be better off sticking to regular computers. Feynman finished his speech by saying he's not happy with attempts to model physics just using classical theory, because nature isn't classical, dammit, and if you want to make a simulation of nature, you'd better make it quantum mechanical, and by golly, it's a wonderful problem, because it doesn't look so easy. So why don't we see quantum computers everywhere already? Well, it comes back to what Feynman said, quantum computing isn't easy, and many smart people are trying to work out its challenges. One of them is noise. Quantum computers, like all electronic devices, can experience interference. Imagine a phone call getting disrupted. Similarly, quantum computers can get affected by various sources, such as electromagnetic waves from Wi-Fi or fluctuations in Earth's magnetic field. This interference causes the data in qubits to degrade. Traditional computers are relatively resilient. Their building blocks, transistors, can perform billions of operations every second for countless years without any interference-induced faults. On the other hand, quantum computers are delicate. A qubit can become unpredictable from interference in mere milliseconds. Quantum information is actually very fragile. Even a measurement can destroy it. That's why we don't take a measurement of the quantum state until probably the last step in our process, because we don't want to destroy that state before we've finished performing the computation. And as it says here, more is worse when it comes to qubits, because they each bring their own noise, and there's additional noise when the qubits are connected together. The more qubits you have, the more difficult it is to protect detect that fragile quantum information. It says here that someone moving a chair in the lab housing the quantum computer is enough to change qubits, so there's an almost endless list of possible errors. The quantum computers that we have today are small and noisy, so we can't use them for the same things that we would want to use a perfect quantum computer for, and instead we are currently looking for things that are okay to use a noisy quantum computer for. There's actually a name for the era of quantum computing that we're currently in, which is NISQ, or noisy intermediate scale quantum. And this plot here shows the situation. The green line is digital technology, or normal computers, and it shows that in the past, in what they've called the digital era, these normal computers were better at doing things, they had more computational power than the early quantum technology. But the power of these technologies is getting closer, until this point here where it's going to cross over. This is the point when quantum technology is going to be able to do more than what digital technology can do. That's going to be really soon for us and going to be really exciting. Because after that point, the quantum technology will continue climbing and the gap will get wider between what quantum computers are able to achieve and what digital technology could. That would be the quantum era. It says here that when a device is built with a few hundred qubits, not even all the digital computers in the world working together would be able to store its state in memory. And so with just a few hundred qubits, we'll be able to do things that no digital computer would ever be able to do. The only thing really standing in our way and preventing us from building that right now is noise. One way to reduce noise is with error correction. Error correction algorithms have been made and used for conventional computer chips like the ones that are up in space. They needed to be more resilient to radiation that could cause errors. For the quantum version of error correction, the key idea is to encode a single qubit of information across multiple physical qubits, creating a form of redundancy. By spreading the information out and entangling the qubits, any errors that occur can be detected and corrected without directly measuring the qubit's value, thus preserving the quantum information. Inevitably, some qubits will go bad, but if at least half are still good, then you should be able to correct them. The problem with this approach is that it requires more qubits, which bring their own noise, and then the number of qubits required to perform basic error correction balloons out to dwarf the original qubits by as much as 1,000 to 1. It's theoretically a viable approach, but right now there's a global research effort just trying to get to the break-even point, where it's actually beneficial to use quantum error correction, given how many resources it takes. The other, more obvious way to reduce noise is in the hardware itself, in cooling the quantum computer to below the temperature of outer space and shielding it from the surrounding environment. Scientists are also exploring the very best and least noisy materials that they can use to make the qubit. But there's one other approach to reducing noise that's kind of in between these two. It can be thought of as quantum firmware and protects the qubits against noise without needing extra qubits. One method is dynamic stabilization, which applies a sequence of precisely timed pulses to the qubits. These pulses effectively refocus the qubits and counteract the effects of unwanted external noise. This concept is somewhat similar to techniques used in medical MRI scans, where timed pulses help to produce clearer images. The goal of dynamic stabilization is to average out or nullify the effects of environmental disturbances over time, and as a result, the qubits are able to maintain their quantum state for longer, allowing for more accurate quantum computations. Some noise sources might not be mitigated by this technique alone, so dynamic stabilization is often used in combination with other error correction and noise reduction strategies. Q Control, who is the sponsor of today's video, specialize in making this kind of quantum firmware. Their software helps to make today's quantum computers actually useful. They also have an educational platform called Black Opal, which teaches skills that would be useful in the quantum computing era. I have enjoyed working through their course on quantum fundamentals. Black Opal allows you to build interactive circuits, and this is my favorite part, seeing the relationship between parts of a circuit and what's going on with the state of the qubit. X is a quantum gate that is analogous to the NOT gate in classical computing, so it will change a 0 to a 1 or a 1 to a 0, and it does that by rotating 180 degrees around the X axis. The Y and Z do the same, but by rotating around their axes. And combining them, you can trace a path around the qubit. H is the Adamar gate, which puts the qubit into a superposition between 0 and 1, so halfway between each state. There's a link in the description where you can sign up for free to see for yourself if you would enjoy diving deeper into some of these quantum ideas, and you can use the offer code Tibees to get 20% off their pro plan. This could be the start of your journey into a career in quantum technology. After all, there are many quantum computing companies out there now, and they all need to hire people of all types. Not just physicists, but software engineers and marketers, product managers and designers. And understanding the fundamentals of quantum computing can really help to get into those jobs in quantum computing companies too. Thank you to Q-Control for sponsoring this video, and thank you for watching. Also, thank you to my Patreon supporters for making these videos possible, and a special shout out to today's Patreon Cats of the Day, Duchess and Rudy.